listening to Heroes Forge, a Heroes of the Storm podcast.
Welcome, Forgers, to episode 17 of Heroes Forge, a community-driven podcast all about Heroes of the Storm. I am your show host, Jeff Reynolds, and I am here with the outstanding show co-host, Kristen Ashton. Hi, Kristen. How are you?
Hi, Jeff. I'm great today. How are you doing?
I am ecstatic. There is so much to talk about. And first and foremost, we have to welcome our show guest this week. I am beyond elated to have the host of the hit Heroes of the Storm podcast into the Nexus and the unmatched Heroes of the Storm coach, Mr. Kyle Fergusson. What is up, Kyle?
Thank you for having me here. This show is awesome. I am so jealous that I have to work with hardcore facts,
yeah,
on a daily basis, and you guys get to play D&D, play pretend. Like, oh my god.
Yeah, we have zero hardcore facts on this show.
There's lore. The lore has to be at least somewhat on point.
Touche. And you are a busy guy, man. I saw you were streaming with Jocelyn today. You were out. I mean, you're doing a ton of stuff.
Yeah, it's evolved for me, and it's a full-time gig, and it's fantastic.
Yeah, man, and I am so happy that you're joining us today. And I mean, there's tons of stuff to talk about, but first, I really, really want to let everyone know, this has been on my mind all weekend. We are now part of the Amove.tv crew. It's just outstanding that we get to be a part of an amazing podcast group and entertainment group like Amove.tv, where our stream is going to be on Amove.tv. It's still going to stream every Sunday night at 7 p.m. Pacific. We're going to be moving over there next week to that channel. So check us out there and check out all of the great, amazing esports and video game podcasts over on Amove.tv. I mean, there's Into the Nexus, which Kyle is a host of. Then there's The Angry Chicken, which is all about Hearthstone. Of course, The Angry Nerd, which is Garrett Reinzerl's solo show. There is The Gamers Inn, which is a great show that talks about all different kinds of games and video games and just awesome stuff. And Kristen, of course, is the pre-show host of the Into the Nexus pre-show, which is great too. I mean, I can't stop talking about how much awesome stuff there is over there, Kristen.
Well, I'm glad you can't stop talking about it, because it's definitely been a big part of my life for a long time now, years even, if I think back to it. So it's definitely a big moment in my life too. I've been a little excited.
Yeah, and the truth is that we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the crew over at Amove.tv, because that's what really inspired us to create this show and to have, you know, our own community. And now that we get to be a part of that Amove community, it is crazy, crazy awesome. So more about that later, but I wanted to get that out of the way. Let's talk some heroes. I mean, Tracer is in Heroes of the Storm now.
Yeah, she is. And she's crazy. She's insane. I've been watching Kyle play this hero. I don't know. How many hours have you played her already, Kyle?
A couple. It's been a blast. She is. The fun creep is real, is really what it comes down to.
Oh, yeah.
Everything's starting to look a little boring in the background when you put up against Tracer and Dahaka.
Oh yeah, definitely. One of the things I am bummed about, and you guys touched on this in Into the Nexus the other day, but I think they really missed the mark with the rollout of her when it comes to the pre-orders. It's really tough, because I thought I was going to be able to play Tracer, but all I got to do is run around with Arthas and Malfurion in the tri-mode, because I ordered the edition from Amazon, which comes like the statue and everything, and I thought I was going to be able to do it.
Oh, really? So it wasn't the Origins edition then? It was...
I think it's still called the Origins Edition, but it's the actual physical copy of the game. It comes with the soundtrack, the art book, I believe, the statue of Soldier 76 and all this stuff. So I was down, because I have bought into Overwatch for sure. So I love the game, so I thought I'd go that way and they'd send me a code, but alas, I cannot.
Nope.
Really? So it was just the digital copy then?
Just the digital copy off of battle.net, which is crazy to me. But, you know, I'm so happy that there are people out there that are really enjoying her. I mean, she has a massive win rate right now. It's really, really... I mean, Kyle, in a nutshell, what do you think is a good way to counter that? I mean, she's just so mobile.
Yeah. My forging may be a little influenced by Tracer today.
Uh-huh.
May have been thinking about Tracer counters. I honestly like Rainer a lot right now.
Uh-huh.
It reduces her to ridiculous. Because you just stand there, you shoot her in the face, but she's like dancing, she's doing all these fancy things, backflips. It's the Indiana Jones problem of the guy wheeling with the sword and swinging around something, you just pull out the revolver and shoot her in the face.
Oh, that's one of the best parts.
She busts her buns, which have been in the news a lot lately. She busts those buns. And all you do is just stand there. Also, Sylvanas is a fantastic counter. Either you go the silence arrow or the mind control, anything, any silence in the game that shuts her up is just, you're dead because you're always relying on that recall or that blink out after you get aggressive.
Yeah, and I bet you kind of get comfortable when you're in there. You get really good at blinking back and, you know, rewinding rather. So if you were silenced, you'd be in a bunch of trouble.
Well, and she doesn't have a level 10 adjustment to make. So if you hit level 10 and your ability counters Tracer, there's an awesome chance that you're just going to catch her completely off guard because 10 doesn't matter. She already has her ultimate.
Yeah, also crazy. I cannot wait to try her when she finally comes out. It's going to be really great. Kristen, speaking of Heroes, have you played any this week?
I may have played a little bit of Heroes. Did a little 12-hour stream on Friday, which was amazing. And I can confirm that even after 12 hours, I still love the game. And I will continue to play this game.
Oh, you got to talk about it a little bit. So within 12 hours, did you stop to eat?
There was food brought in to me. Kyle was very, very kind. He brought in some snacks that I managed to shovel into my face off camera. I learned that I am not a good Tychus player, not even a little. We won 20 games maybe because I was getting him to 9. I was getting him to 9.
Wow, 9.
Yeah, you stop caring about the losses. You turn on some good music, you jam to some 80s and, you know, whatever. And then you pull out the murky and suddenly you're winning again.
Oh, that was great. I was there for when the murky came out. I had the pleasure of joining you for a couple of games there. And it was, I mean, kudos to you because the 12-hour stream, I can't do anything for 12 hours except breathe.
Well, that's impressive. That's a feat all of its own, right? Because that means you get to keep living. So it's good. It's
true.
Life is good.
But kept the sanity. You take breaks every 3 games. You get up, you dance, do some push-ups, you know.
Yeah. That's the rip for BlizzCon way to do it.
Yeah.
It's like I saw this blog. This is completely off topic, but somebody is training for a half marathon, which I am as well. And they said, you know, I really solved the problem of what to do at red lights when you're running on the street. You get down and you start doing push-ups.
Mm.
And I thought, the only thing worse than running is stopping to do push-ups.
Fair enough. Push-ups have been the bane of my existence ever since I've been like 5 years old.
Well, you're a professional. I mean, it was a very good stream, and there were lots of push-ups, and it was a lot of fun, including the Let It Go puppet show at the end of the stream, which, I mean, I'm not even going to talk about it because you need to just watch it. So we'll find out a way for everybody to be able to watch that because it was riveting. It was fantastic. Kyle, what other games are you playing out there other than Heroes of the Storm right now?
Honestly, I'm trying my darndest to beat Darkest Dungeon.
Oh, I loved Darkest Dungeon.
It takes a lot of work. Mm-hmm. And I've never beat XCOM, and I have to keep the through line going, otherwise I forget. And the second I forget my characters' names, I stop caring, and I have to restart at some 6-month out period when I'm interested again.
Right.
So I'm making sure I like dedicate an hour to each night to Darkest Dungeon so I just understand what I'm up to so I don't just get overwhelmed. But man, is it getting... It's getting a bit grindy. I just beat the final version of the canon.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm supposed to grind out to the inoculated flesh final version, and it's just rough.
Yeah, I remember feeling the exact same way at the end when I played that, which was when it first came out, which I believe was last summer is when I picked it up. And, oh, but it is the... I mean, especially even at the beginning, it's got a definite, awesome, dark... I mean, Darkest Dungeon feel, right?
Yeah, well, it's a Lovecraft lore. If I'm in a turn-based anything, or even any game, and one of my characters goes at all insane and shoots another character, I'm on board. Those are the mechanics I get into.
Yeah, it and the story and the writing. I mean, the writing is great, don't you think?
The vocabulary is fantastic. It's so villainous. I love discovering the story of your predecessor there.
Yeah, it's really good. And I know at the beginning, for those of you that haven't played it, go play it, especially if you like turn-based stuff like that. It's very fun. At the beginning, you start with a team. And I don't know about you, but at the beginning, I was trying to keep everybody alive.
I started with two dudes, and I still got them.
Oh, good.
To this level, Dismas and Reynolds. If Dismas, my main rogue, dies, I think I'm out. I don't know if I can take it at this point. He has he has carried me through every single boss.
Yeah, it's a hard game. It's very fun. Kristen, have you had a chance to play it at all, or do you look to play it someday?
I look to watch on and enjoy the story. Turn-based games aren't really my thing. I've given some tries, but it's just so boring to me. Sad to say, I understand the art is great, the story is great, the music is great. I respect those things. I'm not trying to say I don't respect that, but personally, I just got to have the action going all the time.
Yeah, it's I got to be in the mood too. So I completely understand where you're coming from. Speaking of really, really dark things, I mean, tonight, do you guys watch Game of Thrones?
Yes.
Oh, tonight is the season premiere of Game of Thrones, and I am so excited.
I know, I'm expecting Snow to be resurrected.
Oh, gosh, I don't know. Maybe.
Oh, come on. Now, in the first episode, we got to fart around and, like, Dorne for half of it. And then maybe. No, not even. It's the first episode back. There's going to be nothing revealed. It's all going to be set up and just, I don't know if I can do it tonight. I may wait like 2 weeks and just binge it because I can't handle having a filler episode to start with.
Yeah, you got to
know that's what's happening.
Completely disconnect from the world then if you're going to do that, because I'm sure it's going to be a ton of stuff just getting thrown out on the interwebs about everything that's going on. But I'm going to try to watch it tonight and see how it goes. I mean, we just build this up, right? It's kind of like when a new video game is about to come out. We just build it up and build it up and build it up. And then when it finally comes, we're just like, oh, well, that was exactly what we thought it was going to be.
Mm-hmm.
So
go ahead.
No. What were you going to say?
I was going to say, and here's to hoping they can actually give us a riveting story, because now we're starting to breach into the period where we don't have books to follow any longer.
Yeah, and that's a scary, scary world to travel into. But it's promising for me because George R. R. Martin is producing the show, so he still has a say in what goes on. It's probably going to be different than what's in the books, but still, it's going to be good. I'm excited for that. Lots of dark stuff to talk about today. You know what? Let's get on with the show. I am so excited what's going on, what's going to be going on here in just a few minutes. So let's go ahead and let's forge.
Let's forge.
All right, Forgers, if this is your first time listening to the show, if you're coming over to us from Amove.tv, welcome. This show is a Heroes of the Storm podcast, but it's a little different than any other of the shows that you may or may not listen to. What we do is we take a hero from one of the Blizzard universes and imagine, or forge, if you will, what that hero would be like if it was implemented in Heroes of the Storm. We have a plethora of different characters throughout World of Warcraft, Diablo, Overwatch, Hearthstone. I mean, there's a ton and ton of characters for us to talk about. And we've talked about a lot of them. I mean, this is episode 17. Chris and I have been doing this for a while. So if you want to check out some of the heroes we have forged in the past, we did Deckard Cain, the Dark Wanderer. We forged Onyxia. We forged Nazdormu. Tons of stuff. You can check it out at our website, which is heroesforge.club. Over there, we have VODs and recordings of everything that we've done. But we need to move on to the main event, which is what is being forged tonight. Kyle is our guest, so he got to choose what we're forging. Kyle, tell everybody what we're looking forward to.
Well, it would have eventually happened anyway, because he is eternal. It's Mal'Ganis.
Mal'Ganis. Oh, and yeah, I especially the Dreadlord aspect and the whole thing, you know, with Warcraft 3. It's inevitable in a whole bunch of different ways, right?
It was tough for me to decide which Dreadlord I wanted. I'm ultimately, my little boyness goes towards Arthas because he's just so cool. And Mal'Ganis was so tightly tied to him. But you have Sylvanas and Varimothras, and then Balthazar, who was just so charismatic, so evil. It was tough to decide on a single one.
Yeah, I think you made a really good choice, especially because it's directly linked to Hearthstone. And, you know, recently, not super recently, but we have seen Mal'Ganis in World of Warcraft. So it's a very, very good pick. So moving into lore, this is the part of the show where we just talk a little bit about the character and its place in the Blizzard universe. Kristen, why don't you give us a little rundown on Mal'Ganis and where he came from?
Can do. Nothrazim, Thal'Kitun, Dreadlord. Mal'Ganis has many names and has worn many faces. Like his brethren, Mal'Ganis was chosen to work through subterfuge, tricking the powerful Prince Arthas into pursuing a false hope. After making it appear that he himself was in charge of the plague sweeping through Lordaeron, Mal'Ganis had no trouble leading the proud prince up to the icy tundra of Northrend, where the Lich King sat in anticipation of securing a host. In a world of double crosses, it was surprising that Mal'Ganis never predicted the Lich King would then order the newly possessed Arthas to kill the Dreadlord. It was nothing critical, though, as Dreadlords do not die. Mal'Ganis was later found to be posing as Baron Westwind of the Scarlet Onslaught. Forced back to his alien homeland, though, he now sits plotting future revenge.
Future revenge and never dying. Sounds like an awesome Heroes of the Storm character, don't you guys think?
I would agree.
I know we're a little full of vengeance right now. I mean, vengeance is my only solace. Vengeance on Illidan. It might be a little full at the moment.
Yeah, and, you know, that's a good thing to note, because on the show here, we pick heroes, and sometimes, you know, like, we've done a couple different rogues that may or may not have stealth, and, you know, it's probably not the time for Heroes of the Storm to have another stealthy, to have another poke assassin like that, you know, so this is for the future, but I can definitely see a Dreadlord and even Mal'Ganis in the game, don't you think, Kyle?
I think he's the only one waiting in the sidelines right now. We're going into WoW Legion.
Yeah.
He's planning. He's been planning since forever now. He's got to do something. It's his homeland.
Yeah, I think he'll definitely make an appearance there, and then maybe that'll be the whole, like, pre-order the digital copy of Legion, and you can have Mal'Ganis.
But not just the digital copy, the Digital Origins Special Version 2 copy.
Yeah, online only, non-Amazon. Yes. Yeah.
Online only. Yeah.
So I do think that's going to be Gul'dan. I think it's going to be Gul'dan.
Oh, yeah. Gul'dan is on the way, too. I'm thinking that we're going to get some more, because the game is populated with a bunch of Warcraft characters right now. I'm looking in the future. I think StarCraft is going to be the next character coming out for the actual game. But, you know, who knows? Maybe they'll go off the wall. Dustin Browder did say that there are some. Somebody tweeted at him and said, do you have any weird things coming out? I like to play Lost Vikings, Abathur, you know, Cho'Gall. And he said, it depends on what you consider weird or odd, but we do have some really cool stuff coming down the pike, which is the whole reason we play this game, because there is a whole bunch of cool, different MOBA stuff. Right, Kristen?
It is. And I'm really excited, too, to see if they bring over some of the Dota 2 heroes, of course, in their original, newly updated form, but there are a lot of abilities over in Dota 2 that would really kind of change the face of current combat.
Right, and Kyle, how many heroes, because you played Dota 2, right, how many do they have over there?
I'm not even comfortable saying anymore. You're asking me how many Pokemon there are, and to me, there's only 150. But still, it keeps growing, and there are ones that are not part of my legacy with that game anymore. And there's several that haven't been added to the game that were part of the original Dota.
Oh, man. Heroes is going to get there. I mean, when I go to the Heroes Hero League selection page, and it is prepared to have multiple pages and hundreds of heroes. So this show has some really good backbone, I do think. Okay, great. Enough of the talk. Let's get into the forging of Mal'Ganis, Kyle's choice this week. The first thing we always start with is the role classification in the game. If this character was in there, what would they be? And I went with, And, you know, maybe this is a little bit of bending it from Warcraft 3, but just the actual silhouette of Mal'Ganis in the game makes me instantly think warrior.
I'm right there with you, Jeff. I'm a warrior as well.
Great. Okay, couple warriors. Kyle, what was your build?
I went melee specialist.
Ooh. Yeah, I was torn between doing a specialist or a warrior. And as Kristen knows, when I forge warriors, it's a little tougher for me. And I've done a bunch of specialists. So I thought, this is going to be a good challenge. And Kristen, why were you thinking? I mean, what was your first thought on why Mal'Ganis would be a warrior? What were you thinking?
My first thought is because he leads battles. Though he doesn't do it physically, the stories that are told is that he leads people to their end. And that, to me, speaks to warrior. But I can totally understand specialist.
Yeah. Kyle, what were you thinking? First off the bat, first thought, you thought Mal'Ganis specialist.
Actually, no. My first thought was warrior because in Warcraft 3, he's just throwing himself in there. Mm-hmm. And Arthas, over the course of the Strathul mission, the culling, you kill him maybe 7 or so times, but he's always there in melee. But it's been a little retconned by Metzen over the course of the last couple of years, and Dreadlords have become a lot more sinister, a lot more planny, not as hands-on, but I remember the first time I was going through Stratholme and the Scarlet Quarter, and you get to the end, and it's all led by a Dreadlord. That was awesome.
Yeah.
And that's kind of the embodiment I wanted to have, is who's in charge here, and are they real?
Definitely. I think that's a huge piece of Dreadlord lore. I mean, I've read a whole bunch of stuff this week thinking about this build and thinking about how Dreadlords, I mean, in the lore, prefer to sit back and watch what's going on and control everything that's going on. So that's a definite way that you could go. 3 awesome builds. I cannot wait. 2 warriors and a specialist. Let's get into mounting abilities and what we were thinking. This is our thoughts on how the hero would mount. You know, some heroes in the game like Diablo don't actually get to ride a mount. And that was my idea for Mal'Ganis' mount. Dreadlords are massive creatures that have a demonic air about them. In my build, Mal'Ganis does not have the ability to mount, but instead he can use his massive wings to hover above the ground and move at a mounted speed. All of the same mounting traits apply. He can be dismounted, all that kind of stuff. Kyle, what were you thinking?
You know, I wanted to put him flying because he got those wings, but when you clicked Mal'Ganis too many times in Warcraft 3, I remember him saying, "If I have wings, why am I always walking?" I couldn't in good conscience make him fly. So I gave him a Dreadsteed, because he's a Dreadlord, he needs a Dreadsteed.
Oh yeah, Dreadsteed would be sweet. Oh, so cool. And I do remember that line too. And I mean, do they fly in Warcraft, do you know, Kristen? Or I don't think they do either. I think they're always walking.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, that's crazy. Crazy funny. So what were you thinking, Kristen, for the mount?
I went with the wings.
See, we're on the same page over here. Mm-hmm. I love Kyle's build because it's different than ours, which is perfect. Okay, so 2 hovering or flying Mal'Ganises and 1 that's riding a Dreadsteed, which I definitely want the Dreadsteed again for other heroes in the game. I mean, I think that's something that could definitely be added at some point, too. Let's get into the basic abilities. This is where we start having fun, forging and creating some ideas. So let's start with Kristen. Kristen, what do you think his first basic ability would be?
Well, first basic ability, I'm going with something called sleep. And this seemed like a very big, big part of Mal'Ganis. And so Mal'Ganis puts to sleep target enemy unit or hero. While asleep, the enemy is essentially stunned. Unlike a stun, however, this ability is broken by damage.
Great. I think you'll agree, Kyle, that definitely speaks to the Warcraft 3, because that was one of the builds that you could go, correct?
Yeah, it was right there on his basic tools. This was only multiplayer, because you never got to control Mal'Ganis.
Uh-huh.
But you would get a Dreadlord if you were the undead race, and sleep was huge. It was game-changing. But then people figured out that you could attack the target, your friendly target, to wake him up. And it lost a little bit of its power in the pro scene as Warcraft 3 developed its tiny pre-esports streaming
right.
Pro scene back in the day. And did we all do a sleep? Did we all go with some kind of?
Yeah.
I think we all did.
I think we did.
So are they allowed to attack their own teammate to wake them up? I think damage, yes. If I get hit in the face with a baseball bat, I will wake up, sure.
Yeah, I put that in there. On my sleep ability, I said, well, first I started it out with saying, not sure about this, but another major ability for Dreadlords in Warcraft 3, just like Kyle talked about, is sleep. This is different than a stun in my build. His ability is activated and Mal'Ganis uses his demonic magic to put a target to sleep. This target will be stunned and unable to attack or move until they take damage. So at that moment, they are put into sleep and also become targetable by the enemy team and friendly team and their minions. So the enemy team can attack the friendly hero to wake them up, and the minions, both friendly and enemy, will target the sleeping hero with priority.
Which isn't crazy. We have Cocoon, so maybe we could get some sort of visual indicator in the game that would let you know they were asleep. And the strategy comes in, like, who attacks them?
Right. And I think there's a whole lot of strategy. I mean, again, I talk about this every week, how I'm playing in the bronze leagues. I can see how, you know, poor little Vala would be down there asleep, you know, spamming chat. Come and wake me up. Come and wake me up. I'm in a, you know, I'm somewhere over here, and nobody goes down there to wake her up. So in my mind, it would inspire team play.
Well, you'd hope so, much like Cocoon does. But again, at that point, how many times do teams actually rally around the poor Cocoon figure and get them out before team wipe happens?
Yeah, it's a little crazy. So, Kyle, you had a sleep on your build, too?
Yep. Mine was a four-second-long sleep. Not really identifying stun or anything like that. I think it would be its own CC, like Polymorph is, not affected by, you know, any sort of relentless skill in the game. And damage would wake them up. Area effect damage would wake them up. So if Kael'thas happened to have a flame strike in the area, bad idea to maybe go with our Dreadlord in that particular comp. But the best thing about sleep was they just didn't take any damage, but you could get your body block prepared. And I am a huge positional player. I love body blocks, and being able to get that off while someone is just stuck helpless as you position perfectly around them is fantastic.
Oh yeah, I completely agree. It'd be tough in a team fight though, right? Because if things are flying all over, you know, stuff's going crazy, people are popping their ults, and you just don't want to hit that one person, right?
Mm-hmm. And of course, there's the question too, how hard would it be to wake them up from sleep? Because do you want them to be instantly awake if they take damage, or to have a meter?
Yeah.
Hmm.
What do you think, Kyle?
That's an interesting idea. I think Blizzard players are very well trained for something like sleep, with saps, with, you know, just all those Warcraft mechanics over the years. I don't think it's insane to just have it be any damage wakes them up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I could see how that could go either way, Kristen. That's a really good point. Cool. Very cool. So starting out with three sleep abilities, we're all on the same page here. Let's move into second basic abilities. Let's hear, Kyle, what's your second basic ability you're thinking for Mal'Ganis?
Well, I went with a specialist, so you got to have a good, efficient lane clear, and they can be a little boring. I think Spectral Scythe on Zul is a little boring. It doesn't need to be super flashy or have CC tied to it 24/7. So you know what? A nice, solid cone effect, Carrion Swarm.
Carrion Swarm, I like it. This is another Great Minds moment. I'm thinking the same thing over here, but I want to hear about yours. So you're thinking it shoots out in a cone with the kind of, because the Carrion Swarm in Warcraft is bats, correct?
It's bats, it's bugs, it's vermin. You know, it's what the game was able to accomplish with a little bit of bats and a little bit of like fly looking things in there. What would that look like today? I think it'd look real cool. I don't know who's in there, whether they're all just decaying frogs or whatnot, but there's awesome possibilities.
Oh, and here's a question. Visually, so it's going after minions, lane clear. Would it crawl over and cover the minions and consume them? And then as the swarm pulls away, they're all dead? Kind of like the scarabs in the mummy?
No, it's more like a dragon's breath.
Okay.
And it would just shoot out with the wave, not really leaving an effect on the ground by any means. Just simple, clean damage.
Yeah, and that's needed in a specialist, like you said. Kristen, what were you thinking for a second basic ability?
This one, I'm going with something called True Destiny. Never one to go without tempting others to find and fight him, Mal'Ganis can activate his trait to cause himself to become visible on the mini-map for an extended period of time. and not trait, his ability.
Oh, wow. Okay, explain just a little bit. How would we use this in the game? I'm trying to fill us in a little bit.
So I'm trying to, because we all know you don't want to give your position away on the minimap.
Mm-hmm.
In general, because the team can find you and they can get you. But what if you set up traps? What if you want them to head top because your team is going to sweep bottom and try to take the last bit of a keep's health?
Oh.
What if you want to be like, oh, look at what I'm doing to these mercs right here while your team tries to go grab boss top?
Right. I love it. And as soon as you said traps, I went back to our build from last week, Edwin Van Cleef, where you could have that great forger idea with the kind of ambush setup with your own sort of controllable harvest golems. So that would work in a situation like that. Love it. That is such a cool idea. And it's different than stuff that we have now. I went down the same road as Kyle for my second basic with the swarm. And one of the main abilities of a dreadlord in Warcraft 3 was this swarm. And when this ability is activated on my build, he sends forth a flurry of bats towards the enemy. And these bats will attack the enemy target and move on to other enemy targets and if they're destroyed. So they're fluttering above and dealing damage until their timers run out or until the bats themselves are destroyed. These bats do small amounts of damage but give Mel'Ganis survivability, forcing the enemy heroes to focus on additional targets.
Nice. So it's kind of like throw a lot of stuff out there and hope the distraction pulls them away from actually attacking your team members.
Exactly. And that ties in directly to my trait for Mel'Ganis, which we didn't get a chance to talk about yet. So I'll go straight into my trait, which is called loyalty. So Mel'Ganis does have a past, and a major moment of his lore is when the Lich King betrayed him and had Arthas destroy him for a time. In the Nexus, Mel'Ganis is ready for betrayal and always watches his back. All consecutive attacks that a hero does to Mel'Ganis decrease their effectiveness during the battle. After each attack lands on Mel'Ganis, the enemy hero receives a debuff that reduces the damage done by the next attack. These debuffs stack to the point of not allowing the enemy hero to do any damage to Mel'Ganis. Now, if the enemy hero attacks another hero or minion after attacking Mel'Ganis, they go back to doing normal damage to him and the stacks restart. This will give Mel'Ganis survivability and also force the enemy team to not go for the tank.
But we like going for the tank.
We do like going for the tank. So this is kind of like, I don't know. This was hard for me because I'm inspired by Artanis. You know, Artanis stays in the battle. He's fighting, gaining shields, doing things like that. And that's his survivability. So how do we make that different? You know what I'm saying? I mean, it's different, right, Kyle? But do you think it's feasible?
So it would have to be very visually clear.
Yeah, you'd have to know.
Yeah, I mean, that's the tough part about it. I love the idea of this constantly evolving character that can get better at what they're currently doing. If you're moving fast, you move faster. If you stop moving, you gain armor or something like that. So it's very fluid. I love that of it. Maybe if it was a slow instead, just a base physical slow.
Because then you would be able to feel it.
Yeah, and then when you tried to get moving again, otherwise maybe you're going into blind territory to truly make it clear to the enemy that they aren't accomplishing damage. Because otherwise you might just get caught up in the moment and keep shooting them in the face and not realizing you're
going
debuffed
for the tank.
Hacking back.
Exactly. Okay, we skipped the traits because I'm so excited about Amove and Kyle and everything. I'm just so excited. So let's move on to let's hear your trait, Kristen. What was your idea for Mel'Ganis?
Okay, the trait I went is called Endless One, and it's because dreadlords can never truly be killed. As such, Mel'Ganis's deaths do not count as hero kills in that no XP is awarded.
Whoa.
So you can kill him and he does get the death timer and he'll spawn from the Nexus, but you don't get XP for killing him.
Wow, that's powerful. That's very, very strong.
Yeah, and you might need to nerf it to half XP, you know, but we're not, I'm not a numbers person, so I'm just throwing it out there. We'll see what sticks, what doesn't stick.
Yeah, Kyle is definitely a numbers person in his build. I'm looking at here, he's got percentages and all of that stuff, which is great. I think that that is such a great idea. It fits into the lore of the Dreadlords perfectly. That's a really tough thing, because that also kind of goes along with what we were talking about before, not going for the tank. It's really going to reward you nothing.
Yeah. Mm.
So, yeah. What do you think?
What if instead it was an active ability that if you could hit it in the... I mean, we have locked and loaded in this game with Tracer right now,
yes,
which is the hardest darn thing I've ever seen in a MOBA. You got to play a quick time event like God of War in order to do maximum damage on the character. So what if there was a window of opportunity where you would fake your death, much as these Dreadlords like to do?
Mm.
And if you could hit the button in that short window, you would find yourself with a reduced respawn time and no XP given.
Oh. That would work too. And it would, and we know they do Divine Palm, right? So those last minute things are totally doable.
Oh, for sure. And they're hard. I mean, they're hard to time out. When I was trying to learn Karazim or even Uther's Divine Shield and everything like that, it's very hard to time out. But I love that idea, Kyle. So it's like it's flashing on your screen like God of War or, you know, those other games like Uncharted. It's saying, hit the A button, hit the A button. And if you can happen to hit it at the right time, then you get the quest completed, rather.
And maybe you even kill yourself when you do it. You don't even get a stasis. You don't get a divine palm.
You deny them.
Exactly. If you're below 25% health, you can kill yourself right now, quote unquote, do a little performance. Even I'd love it if it had some a nice little flare to it as he goes down. And then you would come back on a shorter cooldown and not award XP.
Love that idea. Oh, that is so cool. Killing yourself to take it away. That has a Dreadlord feel, Kristen, don't you think?
Oh, it does, especially because they always come back. Just part of the lore is no one really knows how you kill a Dreadlord. There are theories, but none are confirmed.
Wow. So good. Love that idea. So far, that's in the lead for best ability, I think, or trait, rather. Kyle, what were you thinking for his trait?
You know what? My teenage mind could only handle so much strategy. And I need to be like basic, like the idea of critical strikes, the idea of wind walk. Like there was all these awesome abilities in Warcraft 3 that I simply didn't understand. But when I saw a vampiric aura on the Dreadlord in Warcraft 3, I thought that was the most awesome thing on earth. I said, heck yes, I am going full ghoul. I'm going full abomination. I'm going to never upgrade my skeletal mages so that I only have skeletons. That is such a cool strat. The gargoyles, because they were melee attackers in the air, got the benefit. And then I was looking at our current climate and heroes, and one of the worst things you can do for your comp is to have too many melees. You'll just clog it up. No one's able to actually deliver the hits. And someone like Muradin with reverberation, reducing attack speed by 50% at level 1, can come through and just wipe you out. So what if you were drafting, you found yourself with 3 melees on your team, and you said, excellent. I gave him Vampiric Aura, 15% lifesteal on all melee attacks.
Oh.
Butcher would be back.
Yeah, Butcher would be back. And that's got a definite Leoric feel to it, you know, stealing life. I kudos. That is such a great idea. And that is directly connected to Warcraft 3, like you said. So, 3...
Oh. Question, really quick question. So this trait, would you need to be nearby Mal'Ganis, or would it be global?
That's interesting. I would want it to be nearby because of the ways auras works in the past.
Fair enough.
But we've had plenty of precedents change, so I wouldn't be upset if they got rid of our aura system. It is a little convoluted.
Mm. Yeah, and if it was global, that would be really powerful and awesome. That would be really, really great. Great. Like I was saying, 3 awesome traits. We've gone through 2 basic abilities on all of the builds. Let's get to the 3rd basic ability out here. My 3rd basic ability is called Chokehold. With his massive Dreadlord claw, Mal'Ganis lunges forward a short distance and grabs a target by the throat and raises him up. The enemy is stunned in this position and takes damage over time. While in the air, the enemy is targetable by other friendly heroes and their abilities. This move will act as a shot caller for Mal'Ganis and also make him a great engage hero.
Totally. It would be like the best stun ever, right? Because stuns, they're cool. The giant hammer coming down from Uther, it's nice. But lifted up in the air? Yeah. Unable to do anything?
Yeah, and I just, because Diablo has got an awesome throw around. I love that ability where he charges in, this massive dude comes in, grabs you, picks you up, and throws you down. And like you always talk about, Kyle, on Into the Nexus, that's the guy, I'm stealing words from your mouth, that's the guy that, you know, is the one that we should all be attacking. This guy right here is the one that I'm throwing up. So I wanted Mal'Ganis to have something like that, but just a little different, where he actually, you know, raises you up with this massive, because their claws are huge, right?
Yeah, oh, the visual of it is so Darth Vader. Oh, I love the idea. I am so scared. I think sleep is so powerful. I have been destroyed by it in Warcraft 3 so many times over the ages. I can't in good conscience give him another CC.
Right.
But man, that's cool.
CC's all around. I was playing today with my friend and he said, God, there is so much CC on this enemy team. It's just, you get locked down. It does not feel good to die from a triple tap. It does not feel good to die from any of these things where you're hopeless. It's just a hopeless feeling. So I completely agree. There's a ton of CC in the game there. So probably not the best time for another chokehold or a character that has two CC abilities.
But it's a good time if you're the one playing this hero and landing the shot.
Right.
So it's, you know, side of the fence. Which team are you on?
That's right. Are you got Mal'Ganis and you didn't ban him out? Oh, you're getting two CCs in one character.
Well, there you go. I'm happy with that. I'm not going to complain.
Completely agree. Kyle, what were you thinking about for the last basic ability for your Mal'Ganis?
Oh, this was super tough for me. There's so many abilities I wanted to just push in here. But I ended up going with Possess. Hide inside a friendly or any enemy minion. And in this way, you could stay behind your walls, ride out with the minion wave, completely invisible. If that minion dies, you pop out, or you can pop out early.
That... That is so cool. It's such a great idea. There's no visual indicator, right, that shows that nope. Mal'Ganis is in that minion?
No, and I would love a talent that would allow you to hide inside friendly heroes so they could engage by themselves and have Mal'Ganis show up next to them suddenly.
I want that right now. And can you hide in mercs?
Well, yeah, I don't see why not. Yeah.
Or the boss.
Yeah, could you imagine?
Oh, the boss.
Boss goes down and you pop out with your wings going.
I don't see why not. I mean, I guess that's the same thing. Maybe it's a little OP because the boss would last much longer and they're trying to take it down and then you pop out. Or if you...
Well, I think it's a good compromise because that boss ignores all lane minions. So he will probably trump himself further than you're comfortable going in the first place.
Then you're too deep and you get taken out when you finally pop. Or hiding inside of the dragon.
Oh, yeah. That'd be so... Just the idea of anyone being out by themselves and they've got two guys. They're like, let's just go ahead. Let's blow up this Malfurion. Why are you asleep, buddy? And there's Mal'Ganis.
Oh, there's Mal'Ganis, or, you know, Abathur comes out to kind of smack around a minion wave because he thinks it's safe, and then one of the minions just pops out this giant dreadlord that, you know, puts him to sleep and then just takes him out. So cool. Kristen, what were you thinking about the third basic ability?
For this one, I'm going with something called Empowered Claws. For a brief period of time, Mal'Ganis can empower his basic claw swipe attack, dealing extra damage and marking the enemy unit or hero. If the unit or hero dies while marked, there is a small chance they will revive briefly as an undead minion.
Very cool. Man, these ideas are so good. Oh, you're right, Kyle. This is like Dungeons and Dragons. Like, we're just creating this stuff and, you know, we'll leave it up to Blizzard to come up with all the numbers and all that percentages and stuff. But this is such a great idea.
Yeah, I really enjoyed the Warcraft 3 with the whole scourge. And he gets Arthas to kill an entire city. Sure, they're plagued and they're going to turn anyway. But it's amazing. It's such an emotionally wrenching point. And, you know, everyone looks at Arthas like he's this horrible person for doing so, but he saved a bigger evil.
True. It was the beginning of the end, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, and it's why you want every villain in Dungeons and Dragons or a cartoon show. You want them to be hands-on. You want them to be so much showmanship, presentation. And then when they're about to be dead, when you think you have them against the ropes, they just disappear in the darkness and say, come and find me at XX, my fortress.
Yes. Yes, that is so good. Such great basic abilities. I cannot wait to get into the heroics. So let's do it. Let's get into the heroic abilities. But before we do that, I'd like to thank everyone that has rated us on iTunes. We have some awesome, awesome listeners and forgers out there, fellow forgers. So if you haven't done so yet and you really enjoy the show, head on over to iTunes. You can find our show there just by searching Heroes Forge, all one word. And from there, you can give us a 5-star rating if you'd like. And that actually helps boost other people to find the show on iTunes. And if you like the show and you'd like to support us, we also have a Patreon site. It's patreon.com/heroesforge. Over there you can check out all the awesome goals that we have for the future. This show is just getting started and we have tons of awesome ideas for the future, including battleground forges and lots of really other cool stuff. So with that said, let's get into the heroics.
Heroic.
All right. Best part. This is where we can kind of go a little crazy. We can have some really, really fun ideas in the heroics. So my first heroic ability for my warrior build of Mal'Ganis is called Ghoul Rush. So a common strategy for Dreadlord players in Warcraft 3 was the Ghoul Rush. I actually didn't know this until I did research on it, so let me tell you what it is. This is when the player would attempt to win the game extremely quickly by creating tons of cheap ghouls at the start and trying to flood the enemy base instantly. If this heroic is selected from Mal'Ganis in Heroes of the Storm, he will summon 10 low-health ghouls that do extra damage to enemy heroes. These ghouls slink forward towards the enemy and attack heroes first. Again, this creates a decoy and can be used to deal damage in a team fight.
So it's like March of the Murlocs.
Yes.
Ghouls.
I was inspired by your 12-hour stream with March of the Murlocs, and I thought, you know what? We need ghouls. And I just
pictured
them.
Does he blow into a conch?
Yes, but it's a skull.
Okay.
There you go. Yeah, that's themed. So wait, what's the decoy thing here then?
So I'm just thinking that, you know, because of the trait that I was building in, that other enemy heroes have to attack other things in order for them to do damage to Mal'Ganis. So that's the kind of give and take I was trying to do with this, where you're going to have a lot of different targets to attack, so you're not always forced to just be attacking him. That's the take. The give is obviously for Mal'Ganis, is he's going to be a warrior that does a ton of damage with this. So that was my thought about the decoy. Giving also survivability for Mal'Ganis. If he needs to get out, he can throw out these ghouls and then kind of get out of the fight.
Does he become invisible for a short time?
No.
Oh, so you almost have to do this like off screen.
Right. You kind of got to throw it out there when you're at your last second. And I mean, I'm picturing 10 ghouls coming out, which is a lot. When you think of the skeletons that Zul brings to life, summons, and all that, it's not ever that much other than March of the Murlocs, which aren't targetable, right?
No, I mean, you get the giant arrow, so you have a general direction they go, but they do their own thing.
Can the enemy actually, like, target the little baby Murlocs?
Nope.
So in this case, they would be able to target the ghouls, so it would just be different in that respect.
Yeah. Now, would they wouldn't do anything aside from attack, right? They wouldn't slow or...
No, I don't think so. But, you know, it's it's a basic thing in my mind, but it just doesn't come out as solid. I just picture him needing to get out of a battle or, you know, call a retreat, another shot caller thing where he can just throw these out and say, retreat, 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 and then they're busy taking over the other ghouls. Kyle, what were you thinking about for his first heroic ability?
I'll go with the obvious one here because it's got to happen because it's so awesome. Rain Infernals. And this would do damage in a large area. This is your destroy an entire lane, an entire creep wave. Those three darn catapults that are on your core. Just drop these three Infernals just right down, slam on them. Massive damage. turn into the big flaming green golems and start pushing that nearest lane.
Oh, super cool. So, is it global?
Ooh, well, it does come from, you know, a portal in the sky, so it might as well be, right?
Yeah, it's because mm-hmm. we're calling down, you know, lasers, we're calling down a whole bunch of, you know, crazy stuff. So I could see how that would be global. I really like that. So these Infernals, are they targetable by the enemy team, or do they just, are they coming out like Asmodan demons where you can, you know, fight with them and against them, or are they just, you know, doing damage and then going away?
No, they're big old piles of health. One way to sort of balance it out might be that they sort of burn themselves out. They immediately start losing health as they go, but they hit with melee. So you keep them in your aura, in your area, and they'll heal themselves up. And if you can keep that damage rolling, if there's enough things to hit, you could get these Infernals pretty darn deep.
For sure. And that speaks specialist like crazy. I love that. So you could take out... I mean, you could call it down in a defensive way. You could call it down in an aggressive offensive way, right?
Definitely.
Love it.
Yeah, and it feels like a Merc Lord, but you don't have to actually kill Mercs. You summon your own.
Yeah, very cool.
And if you stay with them, they buff.
Yeah, and it's kind of like taking the place of bribe where you don't have to pay for it, but you do get your own mercenaries. Great point. Kristen, what were you thinking for first heroic ability?
Going with Dark Conversion, and it's kind of building on the third ability that I had. So all friendly units or heroes that have recently died in the area are brought back as an undead unit. Any brought back hero unit results in the dead hero regaining control of their resurrected body for the duration of the ability or until that body's death. Undead units deal damage and poison and have a disorient debuff aura. When disoriented, enemy heroes move in a random direction when given a move command.
Okay, so they lose their kit.
Yes.
So they get this these special traits, rather.
Yeah, it's not really stuff they can activate, but they have control of that body again. So they can do their basic attacks. And try and get people into their aura and disorient.
Wait, so is this passive?
The disorient debuff?
No, the dark conversion.
No, you'd have to activate it.
Okay, so you would see heroes die in your area, and then you would put out this spell that would get them up.
Correct. Almost like, or you see you're going to lose the team fight, so you might as well.
So maybe it's a lot like Mercy in Overwatch.
Yeah, heroes never die.
Yeah, and then everyone gets up for a time period.
Hopefully you can stem the tide of battle back in your favor, but...
Yeah, what? Heroes Never Die might be too much of a positive statement for Mal'Ganis to say.
Sure, maybe everybody dies eventually or something right. like that.
So you might as well use your corpse.
Except for me.
Or
I
you are
die.
Eternal. There we go.
Mm-hmm.
So if I could just dig into this ability, yeah. I would love to see this be passive and basically work as a party Uther. And whenever Uther dies, he keeps on healing. They get to fulfill their basic ability while they are still dead for, you know, and it takes up that death timer. If they're dead for 60 seconds, they come up for 8 seconds and they've got 52 seconds left of death.
Oh, so however much time you're thinking they have left is when they come back.
Well, they always get their 8 seconds as this undead ghoul, but it does eat up the time they would be dead anyway.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay, very cool. So it's happening constantly then.
Just all around him, yeah, level 10 passive. I think that'd be awesome.
That would be amazing. And then we'd have to discuss too, would this work on past minion waves that have died already? So basically come, 10 minutes in, you've got an unending stream of ghouls.
You know, if you're doing that, what if you made it so that they would have died, but they instead live on for 8 seconds with one hit point.
Oh.
Ooh, like tribute minions.
Yeah. Where someone's got to touch them, but if nothing's touching them, I mean,
they might just keep going.
Oh, think about the skill cap for other players that would have to play against Mal'Ganis.
Oh, like, you'd have to have an all-specialist team just to make
You'd have to have your warrior Mal'Ganis versus Kyle's specialist Mal'Ganis.
Oh, gosh.
That would be crazy. Cool, let's move to second heroic ability. So, Kyle, what were you thinking for his second heroic?
This one was really hard for me because I wanted to embody the essence of what Mal'Ganis did in his story, tempting Arthas up to Northrend and making him sacrifice his soul for power in order to defeat him. And I landed on, mainly because of Tracer, I really want more silences in this game. In particular, one, a point-and-click silence. No skill shots, no wailing arrows, just that guy silence. But I didn't want to give it to him as a basic ability because of sleep being so powerful. Mm. So I went with enticing gift, dark gift.
Okay.
Blizzard loves renaming things. Run with it, Blizzard. Silence the target for 6 seconds, draining health per second while they're silenced. Increase their basic attack damage by 50%. Works on both friends and foes. And yourself.
Oh, you can cast it on yourself.
So you could sacrifice your ability to sleep and clear lanes to pump up your basic attacks for 6 seconds, unable to break out of it, frenzied to an essence, and you're losing health in the background, so if you're not actually accomplishing anything with your vampiric aura, you might end up dying.
Yeah, and I'm thinking about how you could put it on auto-attack heroes.
Your friendly ones, yeah. I mean, if they're melee and they can keep themselves going, that'd be an incredible buff to them. If it's on the enemy team, let's say you silence Tracer, sure, she might be locked down. She may be unable to recall, unable to blink, but that's a 50% bonus damage Tracer wailing on your face.
Yeah, and how fast her basic attacks come in, that would be deadly.
Oh, for sure. And I think that, I mean, talk about high skill cap. You really got to find out. I mean, the healer would be a great target. Like, I'm picturing, you know, Moraleses, Uthers, Malfurions, all of the healers, really. I mean, they don't do enough damage, and if they're silenced, then that's even more of a blow to the enemy team. But then on your team, you're looking for the auto-attack heroes, you know, even the... Yeah.
Now, how big would the range be on this?
It would be sizable. It'd be about the size of, you know, maybe... What, like, the living bomb? You got to be close, right? I would want you to be inside the aura range for your friends.
Okay.
Because they will be draining quite a bit of health in the background. And you should be seen doing this because it should have a bit of flair. I mean, I know Blizzard is not going to go through and animate every single character's weapon to have a dark version of it. But right. Hey, in my dreams, right? Let's say that'd be awesome. like Jaina's staff becomes the corrupt staff. The Frostmourne version of her staff.
Oh, how sick would that be?
Dude, that would be incredible. Lily would even have a corrupted little... She would have corrupted cups. They'd be broken and jagged. They would cut your lip.
Yeah, her little rings on her staff would just be, like, broken and torn, and the top would have, like, a horrible serpent on it that's hissing at her. But the skins would mess it up. It's a dream world, sure. And even Abathur clones just have, like, two little pokey tails sticking out of their back and all that... purple mist all over them.
Yeah, it's a definite like Diablo 3 final boss fight kind of feel where, you know, the clone of you is really kind of you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, oh, that's so great though. That ability, oh, I love it. Kristen, what were you thinking for the second heroic ability?
This one, I'm calling it the North Rend. Gotta go with Northrend, right? It's this wonderful place that happened. Mal'Ganis illuminates himself in glowing green light and taunts all heroes by claiming that their journey has just begun. During this speech, Mal'Ganis takes increased damage from enemy units and moves slower than normal. That's the taunt.
Okay.
If Mal'Ganis is able to complete his monologuing, Northrend comes to the Nexus in full force. The ground becomes icy, reducing movement speed for everyone. And the Lich King's armor rises from the ground, encased in a block of ice. Should the enemy team channel the armor, they gain Frostmourne and can permanently kill Mal'Ganis, now being able to gain XP for all of his kills. If the friendly team channels it, they gain Frostmourne and double the death timer for any hero they kill with it.
Oh, man, I absolutely want something like this.
I would love it if heroes could have little mini games that they could start, because the maps themselves are mini games. So why can't we have these moments of, like, you have to fight for this?
Oh, definitely. And this kind of fits into, Kyle, in a previous episode when we did Onyxia, we kind of talked about how Dustin Browder is saying, you know, we have game modes that we're trying out that are crazy, you know, like the arena and other stuff like that. And we thought, what if they had a raid mode where it was one character that was playing, you know, Onyxia, and then everybody had to fight Onyxia. So what if there was one character that was playing Mal'Ganis, and this whole armor thing was part of the battlefield too? Wouldn't that be cool?
I think there's so much room you can do with something as simple as creep. As simple as the Frostwolf symbol that appears on the ground when Thrall does his earthquake. I want to see more of that. And the idea of, like, maybe you're on Blackheart's Bay and there should be a bridge there, and there should be just water that no one gets to walk on, but you turned it into the spire on top of Northrend. And, like, the map just completely changes. A lot like what happens in the final battle against Garrosh in the raid from the previous expansion. You kind of, through Mist of Pandaria, you go through all these different locations as the illusions become real around you.
Oh, that is so cool. Map manipulation. Is that something that they're thinking about? I've heard rumors of that, right?
We can only hope so. I mean, right now we get to break some pots and stuff.
Right.
But actual map changes. I don't know.
Yeah, that's such a great idea. Being able to actually change the map that you're playing on in order to set an advantage for yourself.
Well, and it was part of Warcraft or 3 Dota a very, very long time ago. It was a very cool ability. It went out because of load issues, actually. You couldn't have characters on different powered computers dealing with this effect. But basically what happened was you would target someone, and then in the very top corner of the map, in your own space, you would be teleported to an arena where you would 1v1 them.
Oh, no way.
But it didn't work out because you had to load assets. No one had seen those assets yet. And to have a character, you target them, what if their computer is just bupkis and they lag for the entirety they're in that arena, having never loaded it before?
Then they're dead.
Yeah, and that's why it was removed from the game eventually. But it was a super cool ability.
Yeah, and Kristen, you had that idea when we were talking about Imperius. Remember?
Yeah, because that Legionnaire thing.
Yeah, and I loved it there too. Just being able to call them out and say, you're going to fight me. And then they go and duel. Oh, God. I'm just picturing the chat would be just going crazy if you pick the wrong person or you pick somebody that's so, you know, just the amount of salt. It is so salty.
Where was my team? That would be, I think we need little t-shirts. Heroes of the Storm, # where was my team?
Exactly. Bronze League, where was my team? Or even Platinum, I'm sure. They say the same kind of stuff. Okay, cool. I'm going to go into my final heroic ability. I called it the Chain of Command, and this was actually inspired by Mal'Ganis' Hearthstone card. He is a card inside of Hearthstone. He's a legendary minion. Mal'Ganis is no stranger to betrayal. Some would believe that he is more loyal to his team because of it. When this ability is activated, Mal'Ganis lets out a roar, and all friendly heroes in the area gain a buff to their damage. In true Dreadlord fashion, all attacks that Mal'Ganis lands while this buff is on him return to him as health, kind of like a vampiric assault that Kyle was talking about. This is another survivability talent for him as a tank, encouraging friendlies to fight as a team.
And this kind of plays into the whole Dreadlord lore because it's getting others to fight for him to give him buffs.
Right. Kind of going in there and again, # Bronze League problems. People don't fight as a team. So, you know, another excuse to get everybody together for team fights and to buff them all up and get in there. So that was my thought on that.
I like that ability. The idea of any tank having a sudden lifesteal that they can activate is very cool. What if you were running away and the vampiric assaults healed you from your team? And this was how you got back in the fight, was encouraging your teammates to get aggressive.
Oh, yeah, that's demonic, right?
I'm at a fourth health. I need to be in the back. So I hit this roar. All my teammates know that they are empowered. And as they attack, they heal me up so I can get back in the battle.
Yeah, and maybe you even, you have like this aura around you where your body actually starts like pulsating or growing with all the attacks that they're doing. So there's actually a visual for them to see that this is happening.
Yeah, because we know with Bloodlust, you just get the little face shaking above your character and then it disappears, right?
Yeah.
But yeah, I like your single character would have the visual. So that's another cue that everyone should be fighting and not running.
Yeah, as many visual cues as we can get in the game, I think is great because there's a lot of, I mean, this is a new game and it's been out for a year or so in full force, but there's a lot of people that are getting into it because, you know, I mean, Bud Light sponsors esports now. Did you see that? That's crazy. You know, we're seeing these tournaments being broadcast to audiences that are massive. You know, the Heroes of the Dorm was at the damn Staples, or not Staples Center. That's in L.A. I wish it was there, but not for you guys. CenturyLink Field and all that stuff. So this is really growing and a lot of new players. So I feel like the more visual cues that we have, the better.
Yeah, it would be nice. But we have to be careful, too, because you don't want there to be too many visual cues or aural cues, because then it'll just be a jumbled mess of flashing lights.
It already feels like that at some points.
It'll be like the Dota 2 startup screen all over again. You say goodbye to many new players jumping in.
Crazy. All right, I think we got everybody's builds, correct?
Yeah.
Awesome. Very cool. Now we get to do the really fun and silly part, which is where we talk about if this character had an epic or legendary skin in the game, what would that crazy fun skin be? Kyle, you're our guest, so I want to hear yours first.
Well, he's got the wings, and he doesn't use them. So there's one character I can think of. Well, she does attacks with them now. She's been a little update over time. But I would like Mal'Ganis to have a King of Blades skin.
Oh.
Give him the dreads, keep his horns. He's got the big old claws anyway. Break up those wings, get rid of that skin in between the bones, and make him infested.
Would he have heels?
You know, why not?
Yes, okay. Why not? Oh, I just, the King of Blades. I can see the tune right now, and it would look really cool, I think, with the dreads and the whole, you know, maybe they would come down in front a little bit because Kerrigan's goes straight back, which is kind of feminine, but maybe, like, he would have more of a Jack Sparrow kind of dread thing going on, and he would go in there.
Yeah, good call. And Predator has the same sort of thing going on. They're more messy. They're more flowy.
Yeah, chat room is saying platform heels. What kind of king do you know that doesn't wear platform heels?
Right? Put some goldfish in those.
Bringing it back, man. I mean, if Kerrigan's got to do it.
That's true. That's very true. All right, Kristen, that's a hard one to follow. What do you think for his specialty skin?
I'm going back to Greek mythology with this one. I was thinking Minoganus. Instead of the Minotaur, the Minoganus. As a dreadlord that is never straightforward, it would make sense he would enjoy living at the center of a labyrinth, bullheaded, big-horned, and grumpy to the last. Minoganus does ancient Greek mythology proud. And here with this one, he would have a special mount. It would be called Theseus and the Thread. Uh-huh. And forever infuriated by his defeat, Minoganus runs full tilt after Theseus, who is forever following Ariadne's string.
Wow.
So it would just be like a little dude running with a string in his hand, and he just chases after him.
That is very deep. You're taking me back for this one.
Well, I'd like to see some Greek mythology in Heroes because, I mean, the Blizzard universe itself is its own mythological world. So why not start incorporating, because Leoric, we get to see some of that Norse.
Right.
Norse to it. But I don't.
That's true.
I mean, I don't know if we have much Greek, ancient Greek influence.
Oh gosh, no, but I know that is a huge draw for a lot of people because, you know, there's Smite, which I think is very, very cool idea. That's one MOBA that I wish took itself more seriously for that very reason, because I want it to be a serious representation of some of these, you know, gods that are fighting against each other. So I love your idea.
Thank you very much.
Would you be willing to allow it to be a Tauren on paper?
A tauren on paper? What do you mean by that?
Well, minotaurs are basically taurens.
So, sort of, but taurens don't have the human body, is the thing.
That's true.
Taurens are just big cows.
Yeah, standing cows. Fair enough.
Yeah.
Would he keep the wings?
You know what he could? Okay, so the guy who built the labyrinth, Daedalus, his son was Icarus.
Oh, right.
So he could have the Icarus wings.
Oh, I like that.
And then if you have a power that it has lots of light and heat, they fall apart and reform or something.
It's alternative history where the Minotaur killed the sun and took the wings and flew out.
There we go.
Love. Oh, that is... Ladies and gentlemen, you just witnessed Heroes Forge. That's it. Right there. We just came up with an idea instantly. Just like that. Off of each other. Love it. My specialty skin over here was inspired by tonight's festivities. I call it the White Walker Mal'Ganis. Inspired from Game of Thrones, the season premiere tonight. This would be a massive demon White Walker with claws, and it would spawn skeletal children instead of the ghouls when his heroic ghoul rush is selected.
Oh, so instead of raising the ghouls, would it just touch things and they would slowly ice over and become...
I love
little
that.
Baby White Walkers.
Mm.
Yeah, and that would go, I mean, all of these builds we really could just put together in a way to make one hero pick, you know, cherry pick all of the best abilities from all three of our builds and build like an ultimate hero, because I can see how that would really go well with, you know, hiding inside of other minions or, you know, infesting them in your build. And I think that's great. I just love Game of Thrones too.
Yeah. Oh, so when he died, would we then assume that every hero has an obsidian blade and that you would fall apart upon death?
Oh, that'd be neat.
Or he doesn't die because he's a dreadlord.
Oh, they have it in the game, though, already. When you kill those sand giants
and
they cross their arms and fall back and explode into rocks. What if you did that exact thing on Mal'Ganis and then just broke into glass, broke into ice?
Yeah, ice shards just... Oh, so cool. But then he's back.
Yeah, he melts, reforms like the T-1000, and suddenly we've got a Terminator Mal'Ganis.
Extra specialty skin, the T-1000 for Mal'Ganis.
Each time he reforms, it's from a new universe. You never know which one you're going to get.
Oh, man. And on the note of the T-1000, I think we can definitely say that this hero was forged. Wow, what to say. This has been such a treat to have Kyle on the show tonight, and we have three awesome builds. Kristen went with the warrior, I went with the warrior, Kyle, of course, went with the specialist, and tons of awesome ideas. You know, Kristen's talking about changing, you know, the way that the game is played with the maps and all of that sort of thing, and Kyle is talking about a whole bunch of different actual abilities that were from Warcraft 3 that they could easily, but they could pour over to Heroes of the Storm. Got the bat swarms and all the sleep abilities and a whole lot of great mind moments at this, in this forging, if I do say so myself. It was just absolute blast to have you both on the show. Of course, Kristen as the co-host as always. Kyle, you're our guest, man. You can tell everybody the interwebs are a big thing. So if people want to find you, where can they find you out there?
You can find me on Twitter at Kyle Fergusson, two S's in Ferguson. You can find my Heroes of the Storm show over at ITN. That's Into the Nexus podcast, where we follow news, strategies, and a little bit of the pro scene. You can find my solo streams on Tuesday and Wednesday at 3 p.m. over at twitch.tv/Kyle Fergusson. That's my solo Q&A show, learning, playing solo queue. That's my gig. And then if you're interested in coaching for Heroes of the Storm, if you'd like to be a better player, check out kyleferguson.com.
Awesome. And I can attest to the fact I have taken lessons from Kyle and they have made me much better of a player. So if you're listening to this, go over there and do it. It is worth every second of time spent doing it, because you will it's an awakening, and sometimes a rude awakening when you realize you haven't been doing anything right.
I hope not too rude, right? I know I assault people with information, but
not you being rude, but it is, you know, you just have this moment where you're just, it's a wake up moment. You know, the first thing Kyle said to me in the first lesson was, so I see you were playing Heroes of the Storm before we started the lesson. How'd it go? And the first thing I said was, well, in that last match, someone just called me an imbecile. So that doesn't happen anymore because I've taken these lessons. So I really, I'm a strong advocate.
Awesome. And it's because Kyle puts everyone on a low sodium diet. That's probably the first step toward recovery in Heroes of the Storm.
I have to acknowledge how hard learning is. It's tough, and you guys are already open, so the hard step is done, which is getting people to learn or want to learn.
Yeah, and that's
so before you even meet me, I've got the easy part. I just need to tell you the information.
And you have a plethora of it, so that's totally true. Kristen, where can people find you, as always, on the interwebs?
As always, people can find me at Dream Destroyer, DreamDestryr, over at Twitch, YouTube, and Twitter. And then, of course, my health and fitness blog, rippedforblizzcon.weebly.com.
And you're streaming a lot right now.
Yes, I am. I'm actually getting ready to change up my schedule here. So starting this week, actually, Monday, Tuesday, starting at 9 a.m. and then Thursday, Friday. Thursday will still be 3 p.m. So it's under the works. But Monday, tomorrow, I will be going at 9 a.m. with some more BioShock Infinite.
Oh, you started Infinite now.
Mm-hmm.
Great. You got to complete that whole story.
Oh, I will.
It's very good. All right. Time for all of our contacts here at Heroes Forge. You can also find us at our website, which is heroesforge.club. Again, over there, all of the postings for the previous heroes that we've done. And there's also a contact tab over there that you can submit to us. Once a month, we take an idea from the community and we forge your spotlight that person and we build builds around it. So if you have ideas for heroes you'd like to see on the show, or you have your own ideas on what those heroes would do, send them our way. You can also send it to us at our Gmail account, which is contactheroesforge@gmail.com. Shoot us an email over there and we'll combine all those ideas and have a lot of fun with them. Of course, you can find us on Twitter. Our Twitter account is @ForgeHeroes. Over there, we announce if we have special guests like Kyle. We also announce the heroes that we will be forging on Sunday nights. We do that at the end of the week. So if you want a little sneak peek into Heroes Forge, make sure you're following us over there on Twitter. The show is on iTunes, so make sure you head on over to iTunes to download the show. And you can also find us on YouTube. It's YouTube.com/HeroesForge. And again, if you like what you're hearing and you'd like to support the show, you can head on over to patreon.com/HeroesForge. Over there, you can help support the show and help it grow to be even more forging fun with a whole lot of alliteration. Again, we are super excited to announce that we are part of the Amove.tv team. Next week, we'll be streaming live on Amove.tv. On their Twitch channel. So if you're following us on the Heroes Forge channel, we'll also host over there so that you can catch both, but eventually we'll be just on the Amove TV channel. Make sure that you head on over to the amove.tv website. Again, awesome podcasts over there, including a whole bunch of awesome Blizzard games and beyond. So check that out. Kyle, I just want to thank you again for joining the show. It was an absolute blast having you on and your plethora of knowledge.
Absolutely. I'm thrilled to be here. It was awesome. I've been watching Kristen forge these heroes jealously from the sidelines, trying to keep my mouth shut as I'm like, oh, what about the, oh, don't forget about this. I've stopped. The first one I was pretty bad, so, but I've gotten better. And
it holds me to high standards, right? Because I have to do my homework. Because when Kyle sees what I've created, I have to have arguments ready. I mean, we're talking full-on debate class in high school.
Whoa, dang.
That's good, though. I mean, that's exactly what we want. And we want the ideas from the community because this is a community-driven podcast. We want your ideas. You know, a lot of people are saying, well, what if you did this like Kyle was doing or like Kristen does with me sometimes? What do you want to do with this or that? And so it's fun to create those, you know, dungeon master moments where you can go through and just make some awesome heroes. And we're doing all of the work for Blizzard. I mean,
yeah, pretty much. I mean,
there's nothing else to do, I mean, other than draw it.
And right, like program it or something.
Yeah, record whatever. Some sounds too.
Exactly. Do some other things, but we've done most of the work, and that's that. So thank you so much. That was a joke, by the way, in case you didn't.
Important to say on the internet. So well done. You've seasoned well.
I've seasoned well. That was a joke. I was just kidding. We know they had to do tons of stuff over there that we could never do. Great. Thank you so much again, Kyle. Kristen, thank you so much for being here again. And we will see you all on Amove next week at 7 p.m. Pacific on Sunday night. And we'll see you all in the real world.